Thank you very much, Abeid. Assalamu alaikum. Good morning and shalom. Let me begin by thanking the GPF for arranging and hosting this meeting. And I would also like to thank the participants here and the keynote speakers from the first day we started our deliberations till today. And I believe that much has been learned, you know, through the engagement that we had together here. And this, of course, is very helpful in forging ahead the implementation of the theme that is ethical leadership amid global crisis. We need to learn from each other, definitely. Of course, each one of us may have a unique experience. And today, I'm going to share with you what I would humbly call a unique experience, you know, which I in Zanzibar. It's going to take a little bit, maybe 15, 20 minutes, you know.
Can we keep it a little bit?
Okay, okay. I'll try my best.
Okay.
Because sometimes you cannot just cut on the text that you prepared. But, you know, I'm fast. I'm going to be fast enough. Every one of us has been struggling with the meaning of ethical leadership. And I would say, yes, everyone has the right to have his own interpretation of the word leadership, as long as it leads to peace, security, and the well-being of the people. In my opinion, ethical leadership is related to issues of trust, honesty, consideration, and fairness. An ethical leader leads by example, guided by ethically agreed norms. Now, such a leader must always work to motivate people in his society in general to work together in order to positively and sustainably achieve the objectives that have been set by them all. Ethical leaders have tremendous impact on people's behavior and actions. And those who succeed in leading ethically not only improve the economies of their countries and their societies, but also build among people a culture of trust, respect for one another, and that is very important. Allow me to speak about a living example of ethical leadership from my own personal experience in Zanzibar. You know, as you all know, Zanzibar is a small country in East Africa. It is a semi-autonomous island state within the United Republic of Tanzania, gained its independence after the January 12 revolution in 1964, which ousted the Sultan. Now, the political history of Zanzibar is one of antagonism, has always been one of antagonism and violence. Political tensions and violence began with the introduction of political parties. This is the time when we're all fighting for decolonization and independence for Africa. This was in the 50s and 60s. Now, in Zanzibar's case, we had three main political parties that established. The ZNP, which was established by a land-owning class, mainly Arabs, who were pro the Sultan. And the ASP, Afro-Shirazi Party, is the party of African and Shirazi origin, which was considered, you know, the members of Afro-Shirazi Party were considered as just like second-class subjects of the Sultan. And then there came the Zanzibar and Pemba People's Party, which mostly originated from the sister island of Pemba. Now, the structures of those parties, of course, were with conflicting social and economic interests, of course, and that, of course, led to the violence after elections. Now, competition between those parties was very bitter, severe, leading to hatred and mistrust that lasted more than half a century. Before the revolution, there were four, I think, elections which were held. Only one of them was peaceful. The rest, we had tensions all over. Now, the initiative that we had to take, you know, to reach a final political settlement in Zanzibar. The post-revolutionary government started with the reconciliation of all the Zanzibari people. And this time, you know, because the after every revolution, you know, governments would first suspend or maybe stop the constitution altogether and then rule by decree. So at that time, the constitution was abolished and they established decrees, which were, of course, not discussed by parliaments and passed by the parliament, because there was no parliament, you see. But again, those decrees acted as laws of the day. And I believe that most of them were good decrees. And especially this one, which I'm going to talk about here, decree number six, section six, which recognized the equality of all Zanzibaris people, regardless of their race, faith, or creed. And at that time, discrimination of all sorts was banned, outlawed completely, because all the people of Zanzibar were equal under the law. With that, of course, political parties, the political establishments were also banned. Now, the reintroduction of multi-partyism was in 1992. And that saw the emergence of political divisions again. The repetition of the past came back. Rivalry and hatred, you see, was the order of the day. The new parties, unfortunately, changed by name only, but their style and behavior and ideology were the same, you know, with the old parties. Now, the first multi-party election in Zanzibar was held in 1995. And again, this one was bitterly contested. It led to non-recognition of the government by the opposition. And again, there was bloodshed there, unfortunately. So the next 5 years passed with impasse until election 2000 that followed. And here, fortunately, this time I ran for the presidency and I won. So, having recognized the previous problems, what do we do now? The first thing that I did was to release, that was the first action by my presidency, was to release the 26 so-called political prisoners, because I use the word so-called here, because, you know, I don't believe they are political prisoners, because somebody does not deserve to go to jail because of his political belief, you see? So I released them. And then I formed the Ministry of Constitutional Affairs and Good Governance with the responsibility of articulating the fundamental human rights and observe the rule of law. We did all that with the ultimate goal of achieving the noble word called peace. The second political agreement, with that in mind, of course, we worked on the second political agreement between our political parties. And then we agreed on, first, the formation of the new independent election commission. I'm finishing. I'm just about on the last page. Okay. Independent commission. We agreed both the parties. And you see, you seldom see a government working with the opposition, you see, to reform institutions of the government. We did that. And why did we do that? For the sake of peace again. The second thing that we did, we introduced a permanent voter register. We did the reforms of the judiciary. We created an independent directorate of public prosecution. The GNU, Government of National Unity, eluded us. We had a problem there. But again, the following 2 years or 3 years later, we met again, and we agreed on the formation of the Government of National Unity. This was after the meeting, you know, between the Secretary General of the CUF and myself as the President of Zanzibar. We both underscored the importance of peace and security to our people, and that, of course, our people deserve to enjoy a lasting peace. We also agreed to hold a referendum, just like the one you have here in the UK, because to hold a referendum has its importance. You need, this is a direct democracy, you need the people to vote on the subject that you want to implement. So 67% of the people of Zanzibar, fortunately, voted for the formation of Government of National Unity. And that gave us, you know, the strength to continue with what we had started. So in August, we passed the House of Representatives, passed the bill, and amended the Constitution of Zanzibar. In October, we had the fourth multi-party election there, which was held under the agreed terms. Results were announced, both parties accepted the results, and you see this is a very important milestone. When you have a competitive elections and then both parties agree to the results, there was harmony throughout the political landscape of Zanzibar, and that was an achievement of itself. A few days later, the Government of National Unity was formed, and Zanzibar lived in peace for the next 5 years. In conclusion here now, what I would like to say is that Honorable Seif Sharif Hamad, the Secretary General of CUF, and I worked so hard to achieve what had eluded the previous administration. And it was possible because we demonstrated how ethical leadership can bring about change by respecting values, dignity, and the rights of other people. Thank you very much. Thank you.